anymore. You should do this anymore.
Your love is great. week 5 of a series entitled Mark, and we're talking about the lessons that we can learn from the leadership of David. Today, we're also 1 week away from Easter 2020, and this is going to be one of those Easters that we're going to tell our grandchildren, and some of you are going to tell your children about for a long time. And, you know, we've been facing some challenges like we have never faced before, but we can learn from the life of David that he also faced challenges. And even though we're struggling with certain things like what to do for lunch because we haven't been home at lunch in a long time, or what we're going to watch tonight on Netflix, you know, what we're going to binge watch or something else, there are many of us that are facing struggles that are a lot larger than life. We're facing challenges. Some are facing challenges of marital issues. Some of financial stress. Some of you are facing the challenge of living with a teenager that you gave your DNA to, and it's just not been easy for you, and you're having to work through that. Can I tell you that all challenges that we had that were prior to what we're dealing with in the world right now that's staring us right in the face, I just want to speak a word over you and tell you today that even though this looks like the biggest mess that you have ever faced in your life, that God has got a purpose, God has got a plan, and I believe that it's being worked even right now as you watch this today. I think the big question for most of us is, hey, God, what is on the other side of this mess that we see? What is on the other side of what we're dealing with right now? And, you know, I don't know everything that's in front of you right now, but the good news is this today, that Jesus is on the other side of this mess, guaranteed. He's on the other side, and he's the only one that has the answers to what we're dealing with. So as believers, as Christians, we believe that God has chosen, God has called us, that we are marked, which is the title of this today. And we also believe that God has created us and made us for more. That God never intended for us to stay right where we are, but that God has given us new levels to go to in our faith. And that what we're going through right now is simply to strengthen us. So point number one that I want to share with you today, this morning, is this. You were made to rise above the obstacles. I want to repeat that. You were made to rise above the obstacles. In your life, God has created you to not stay where you are, but to rise to the challenge of the obstacles that are coming. In this life, no one gets to bypass the obstacles to finish the race. You have got to go through in order to complete the race. It's the only way that you can. The only way that you can have victory is rise above and go through it. You don't get a hall pass. I don't get a hall pass for trouble in this life. This is the process, and whatever you are facing right now, you have got to believe that God will help you, but you've got to stay in this fight. The only way that you ever lose a fight is when you get out of the ring and when you never show up for it. So God has called you. This is a fixed fight. I want to say to you today and declare to you, stay in the ring. Don't give up. Don't quit. God has a plan for you. I know that because when I read the Bibles, I find scriptures like John 16:33 that says this, I have told you these things so that in me you might have peace. There's a word we're all looking for. He said, in this world, this current world where we're living right now, you're going to have trouble, but take heart. Look at this. Jesus said, I have overcome the world. Did you hear that? He said, take heart. You need to have peace. You can have peace. Remember that I faced trouble myself, but I overcame the world. And if I overcame the world, you can overcome the world too. I think the issue with a lot of us is this, that we've been taught since we were children or since we were small that any obstacle that we faced was bad, that anything that was in our way was a bad obstacle. you remember if you've parented or you're a grandparent, you remember when your babies were walking or your children were learning to walk as they were small, that you would move every obstacle out of there. You'd say, no, no, don't leave that there. Don't leave that there. They may fall. They may trip. You'd move things out of the floor. Get the clear path so you could say, come to Daddy. Come to Daddy. Come to Mama. Come to Mama. You would do that. And so from little children, we've been taught that every obstacle is bad. I'll give you an example, a personal one of mine. I have three children that I love so dearly. They're all married. They're all on their own, doing very well. But when they were little, they would go up to the refrigerator, and they were small, but they would make these noises, and they would point at the refrigerator, and what they were doing was they were waiting on an adult to remove the obstacle in front of them, or from me or their mother to take our hands and open that refrigerator door and to give them the pudding that they were looking for inside that refrigerator. Can I tell you something today? That God is wanting to help you through every circumstance, through every situation, through every obstacle that you face. But I also want to tell you today that God has put inside of you and given you as a believer the authority to stand in Christ Jesus and upon His Word and to overcome every situation. We need to believe that in Jesus' name we are commanded to have peace, and we need to believe that that peace is for us. Another thought that I had is that obstacles are not always bad, and this is something worth writing down. They're necessary for your growth. Obstacles are not always bad, but they are necessary for your growth. I got a question for you today. What if you're going through something right now that's necessary for you to grow in God's grace for a better future? Look at what James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4 says. This is going to be our anchor text for the day, even though we're going to be talking, or this morning, even though we're going to be talking about the life of David. I know some of you are looking at me, you're like, Pastor, you know, is this really for me? Here's the anchor scripture that I want to give to you. James chapter 1, verse 2, starting there. He said, consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you face trials of many kinds. My first thought is, what? Count it joy when I face trials of all sorts? Because you know that the testing of your faith, look at this, develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature, so that you may grow up, look at this, and complete, not lacking anything. I want to ask you another question today. Did you know this is a test, and the test that you're facing, that I'm facing right now, is not about us failing, because God doesn't want us to fail, but the test that you and I are facing right now is all about our faith. It's all about our faith in God. It's all about trusting Him. You see, God will allow tests in your life knowing that you cannot pass the test without Him, that you need Him in this hour, that I need Him in this hour. And as I have grown in grace, I have learned that life's obstacles do not get any easier, but my faith has grown stronger. It's not like they get smaller, like the obstacles get smaller. It's though that my faith has gotten stronger. Every day, God is helping me to rise above the challenges. Every challenge that I face, every obstacle that I face, I am growing in God. Now, this is what we're going to learn from David's life today. So I want to take us over to 1 Samuel 17, verse 21, and I want us to learn a life lesson from David. And we're going to go into his life a little deeper, to the point that he meets the biggest obstacle that we see or that we know about in the Bible. It's the story that everyone, when you were in Sunday school, remembered. It's the one of where David meets Goliath, or where David faces up to Goliath. So let me take you to 1 Samuel 17, verse 21, and it reads like this. Israel and the Philistines were drawing up lines facing each other. David left the things with the keeper of the supplier. He ran to the battle lines and greeted his brothers. He was like, hey, guys, I'm here. Dad wanted me to show up and kind of help you guys. Hey, I brought some sandwiches. Look at this. As he was talking, somebody ought to just say right there, an interruption comes. With them, Goliath the Philistine, the champion of Gath, done what he had been doing all 39 days previous to David showing up. And as that is, he stepped out from the lines, he got out of formation, and he shouted, look at this, his usual defiance. And for the first time, David heard it. That's what the Bible says. And David heard it. So let me give you this picture here. Notice that David is doing what his dad had told him to do. He's doing what God had commissioned him to do. He runs down to the battle lines. The Bible says he's taking to his brothers some food. We use the illustration that he might be taking them some grills, some grilled cheese sandwiches or whatever it might have been. But he was taking that to them to give them what they needed. And when he gets to where he's at, he says, hey, guys, what's going on, brothers? I'm just here because Daddy sent me here to help you guys out and to bring you these cheese sandwiches. And David is doing exactly what he's supposed to do. But something happens here that really stands out to me, which brings me to the next point, and I'm going to share that with you. Life's interruptions are normally God's introductions. He is interrupted. You and I don't like to be interrupted. When you think about things that interrupt you in life, one of the things I don't like to be interrupted from is sleep. I like sleep. I don't like to be interrupted from sleep. The second thing that I don't like to be interrupted from is I don't like to be interrupted from eating. I want to sit down and eat my meal and not have to do anything else. And then the third thing is if I'm on a mission, I don't like to be interrupted either. If I'm busy doing something, I really don't like to be interrupted. But let me share this point with you or this thought. Interruptions should not be looked at as inconveniences, but opportunities. Interruptions should not be looked at always as inconveniences, but as opportunities. So David's on his way down. He's seeing his brothers. He gives them the sandwich. And the Bible says that as he's talking to his brothers, as he's conversing with them, the giant walks up and this huge interruption comes. And David was doing what he had always or what he had been told to do by his father. But now he's about to face a landmark obstacle in his life that he's never faced before. God would use this moment, not another moment, but this moment, to landmark David's life. And we would all remember this moment, like I said earlier, as we would from as children from Sunday school, that David was the giant slayer. If you ask any child, can you tell me about David? David was he's the one that took down Goliath. He is the one who wound up his sling and took down Goliath. That's what we remember. Well, today, the obstacle in your way, the trouble that you're facing, the circumstances that are in front of you were never meant to destroy you, but I'm going to tell you it was allowed in your life so that you would rise above, so that you could rise above and grow stronger and be introduced to the next assignment. There's a lot of people right now that are upset and they're fussing and they're complaining and all of these things about what's happening in our world. They don't know which direction to go, and especially believers have gotten on this path. But can I tell you that God has interrupted what we know as normal to do something extravagant in our world right now? I believe that with all of my heart. You know, about 4 years ago, there's a story that I thought about many times. There was somebody that approached me about a little car that I had that my daughter had owned, and she was driving it back and forth to college. She got it when she was in high school, and she put a lot of miles on it, and she had gotten her own job, and she moved out. And one day she said, Dad, I've used this car, and I'm finished with it. I'm going to bring it back to you because I have bought a new car. And she brought it back. And so the person that came to me said, Pastor, do you have a car for sale, or would you sell that car? And I immediately said, no, I'm going to keep it because I'm using it to run to the hospital and make trips with it. It's just very inexpensive to drive. And the Holy Spirit, that's all I can tell you, began to deal with me. And I later called that person up and I said, are they still looking for a car? And the person said, no, but there is someone I know. And she's a solo mother with three children that's just gotten her job back. She's been delivered. She's set free. And she's needing some help. And so we met with that young lady. We met with her and we at a neutral place, which was a gas station. My wife and I did. Got in the car. She wanted to drive it. I got in the back. My wife sat up front. The car was being driven. And as we're driving down the road, she said, you don't know who I am or you don't remember me, do you? And all I could think about was all the movies I'd ever seen where at this point, the people, the white people, the fat people get kidnapped and killed. That's all I could think about. And so I was like, no. And she began to tell her story. And we saw how our stories connected to her story and how God had took something that had happened almost 15 years ago and aligned it. He put an interruption in our life to bring somebody. And I am so thankful today that God interrupted my life for a few moments because she's in our church. She is one of our key leaders. She is the one that has helped us so much in making sure that all of this stuff gets online and gets to you and loves Jesus with all of her heart. And her children are like my children. Can I tell you, don't ever discount the interruptions of God, because many times they're just an introduction to the next thing that God has for you. Can I tell you now, when God sends those interruptions into my life, you know, some of you've had those when your tire blew out and you called for somebody like AAA to come to help you, or you called for somebody you didn't know that was emergency services to come to help you. When those interruptions come into my life, I say, God, who are you about to introduce me to today that I'm going to be able to take my purpose to another level and be able to share Jesus with them, to be able to let the love of Jesus shine through me so that I can shine into their life the light of Jesus Christ. You know, David could hear the shout of Goliath in the background. He could hear that. He was interrupted doing the thing that his dad had sent him to do. What happens next in his life? What happens to you? What happens to David? Was the next thing that David did was follow the orders that he knew was, or he followed the next level of order that God had set out for him. My question is this: what happens in life when you're obeying God and something happens to you, something blindsides you, something hits you that's unexpected? You did not see that affair coming. You did not see that divorce, that the divorce papers that you now have. You did not see that death that was unplanned for, unexpected. Many of us get so frustrated with God, and we would just rather drop off the lunch that God sent us to deliver and run out, because I'm telling you, that's just how it feels. But I want to say to you that God is good even in the middle of circumstances you don't understand. What do I need to do, Pastor? You need to change your perspective. And that's what we're going to talk about for the next few moments. If David would have just complained and said, this is more than I can take. I don't like the fact that the giant interrupted me. I don't like the fact that things are the way that they are. All I did was come on an assignment from God sent by my father to deliver this. Listen to me. Not only did God send the giant into David's life, but he provided a sling and a stone. Not only did he give him a sling and a stone, but he gave him a story. I'm going to tell you today that God is writing the story of your life. And there are things that we don't understand. But I just want you to know that God, the creator of heaven and earth, the creator of your life, is penning. He is writing out, amen, your life. And I want you to know that the Bible says that it's good. We may not understand it all, but I believe that he's working it for your good, my good today. I want to take you to point number three as we're getting close in this message today. It's very simple. It's very basic. It's very easy to understand. Number three, look at this. Your perspective will position you for purpose. Your perspective will position you for purpose. Let me say it in an easy way where we can all very much so understand it and get a hold of this. The way that you see yourself matters. The way that you look at yourself matters. When you look at yourself in the mirror, do you see a child of the living God? Do you see someone that God called out of darkness into His life? Do you see someone who is a world changer? Or do you look at yourself and only see the problems that surround you and complain about the things that are going on around you? Let me tell you that David is listening to the trash talking and he's hearing what's going on. Israel had been listening to the same trash talk for 40 days before David ever showed up. Now David shows up, and this is the first time he hears this, because verse 23 tells us that Goliath had been shouting his usual defiance, meaning that he had been doing this every day while Israel and the Philistines were at the battle line. However, David did not run. When Goliath took a step forward, David stepped up. Come on, somebody. I just believe that whenever Goliath stepped forward out of the battle lines to give his taunting and to give his defiance to the living God, it didn't bother little David. The Bible, I believe, if we could see him, would say he stepped up. So let's read 1 Samuel 17, verse 24, and let's see how the men of Israel responded to Goliath. When the Israelites, these are God's warriors, they are armies of the living God, saw the man. Who was the man? The giant? The Goliath? You need to notice that they saw the man. They've been seeing him for 39 days. This is the 40th one. Look at this. They all ran from him in great fear. In great fear. That brings me to a very important point. You know, today, with all that's going on, Christians are the worst about talking about faith, talking about how God can do anything in your life, until we're big talk, until real fear steps in and we get this, what I call FORO. FORO is a fear of running out. We're afraid of running out of food, afraid of running out of toilet paper, afraid of running out of all kinds of different things. I call it FORO, a fear of running out. And then we'll buy every roll of Charmin toilet paper we can find. Why? Why do we do that? Because our perspective moves our position. In other words, we had faith until our faith was put to the test. And then we start moving from faith to fear, and we learn to do exactly what the Israelites did, and we retreat and we leave. Now, look at this. Every decision you make while you're doing that is decisions based on the perspective of fear and not faith. Fear will cause you to retreat to a very dark place because your perspective, you see things one way. Instead of looking at what God's Word says and declaring what it says, that you are the righteous child of the living God, that He created you the head and not the tail, that God Himself owns the cattle on a thousand hills, and He promised that He would take care of you and that He would take care of me. Can I just say to you today, listen to me, your faith doesn't need to waver in the face of fear. It needs to step up and say, I know what you're saying, Goliath. I know what you're shouting at me. I know what you're declaring, but it's in the face of defiance, because I believe that God, who created me, is able to keep me. My faith is just being tested for a battle, but I will overcome because Jesus overcame. Why did David look at it different? Because David's perspective is different. He didn't just look and see Goliath, but I believe that David looked beyond Goliath. I believe that he looked beyond the obstacle that was in front of him. David saw past the giant and saw a big God. He looked past all of that. And I believe that if he could have, he would have said these words: I look to the hills to which my help comes from. I'm not looking at the giant ahead of me. I'm not looking at him, but I'm looking at the help that's coming from the hills. I know it's God. David steps toward Goliath because he could see beyond Goliath to a big God. You and I need to ask ourselves, do we still believe? Do we still have the faith that we once had? Do we still, when we were sitting in church building and we've got 150 to 1,000 people that are represented together, and everybody's got their smile on and everybody's got their dance on, and then it is easy to have faith and to glorify God. But can I tell you, it takes somebody that has been tried in the fire to be able to rejoice with the people faith is going to be tested. When you have a fear of running out, and God is saying, do you still trust me even in the most frightening times that you've ever lived in? Don't shut down. It's a sad thing because many weak Christians shut their faith down during these times. You've got to ask yourself, do I believe the God who saved me, the God that I already knew would be right here, right now, when I needed Him? Or has your perspective changed since COVID-19 hit the United States or the world, wherever you're watching? Has your perspective changed since the biggest obstacle that you and I have ever faced showed up on our doorstep, and now we're hearing about the effects of it that are in our own home state, that are in our backyard? I want you to know something today. I have a peace in my spirit. I've got a peace deep inside of me. But the world did not give, and the world cannot take it away. And I believe that the same God that kept me when I was going through my own personal battles is the same God that will keep you, and He will keep me through the biggest battle that I've ever seen, the biggest obstacle that I've ever faced. I believe that today. I want to read to you out of Romans 12, 1 and 2. Actually, Romans 12 and 2. Notice what the Scriptures say. Notice what Romans 12, 2 says. Do not copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person. How can God transform me, Pastor? By changing the way that you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good, pleasing, and perfect. You know what? God can change, or He can transform you into a new person. God can change you into a new person. But you're the only one can change the way that you think. You're the only one that can have a change in your mind. You see, you've got to see God through the Word. You've got to see Him through the eyes of His Word. And you've got to learn to trust Him with all of your heart. There's a Scripture that says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but my Word will stand forever. I feel like that today should be a comfort to all of us. He said this, that the grass withers and the flowers fade, but my Word will stand forever. I'm going to ask you a question again, another one. I want to know today, is your faith built on God's Word or what you're scrolling through daily? I'm going to tell you that if it's built on what you're scrolling through daily, it doesn't last. But if your faith is built on the Word of God, it will last. What do you mean, Pastor? The Bible says don't copy. Don't copy the customs of this world. Don't do what everybody else is doing. Go to the place that you know that your anchor and your hope is, and that is to the Word of God. You know, all you've got to do is stand. You've got to learn to stand when the problems come in your life and know what God has already spoken about you. It has not knocked God off of His throne with what we're facing right now. God is well aware of it. But I'm telling you this, that God has already said and has given us the answer in His book. And this, we win the battle. It's a fixed fight. Jesus is on the other side of this mess. He's on the other side of your obstacle. You've got to choose whether you will trust Him or you will not trust Him. Or you say that you trust Him, but when it gets bad, you stop trusting Him. I think for many Christians, we want a genie in a bottle. We want a genie in a bottle that we can rub the bottle and He fixes every circumstance and shows up when we rub the bottle. I want to tell you today, you're not serving a genie in a bottle, but you serve a God who created the universe. And on the other side of what you're facing, and the other side of the mess that we're facing right now, there is healing, there is restoration, and there is life. But you and I have to go through it. Jesus said, in this life you will face trouble. And you cannot bypass it. I didn't get to bypass it, but you will make it through. That's a good word today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let me go on to point number four. Number four is this. The right questions can lead you to a victory. want to explain it to you, and I got just a few minutes to explain it. But the right questions can lead you to a victory. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 25 and 26. Look at this. Now the Israelites had been saying, "Do you see this man that keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage, and he will exempt his father's family from taxes in Israel." And David asked the man standing near him, "What will be done with a man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? He should stand and defy the armies of the living God." Now, I want you to notice there's two things that are asked here. Well, there's two questions. Notice the differences in the questions. It's almost as if the children of Israel who had been camped there for 39 days would run out to the battle lines when the Philistines come, and every time that Goliath would step up, he would start taunting and cursing God and mocking and defying the children of Israel. They would look at each other and say, Did you hear what he said again? Do you hear him? Do you hear what he's saying? He just keeps on. He doesn't give up, does he? That's what they were doing. That was the thing. Do you hear what he's saying to us? Do you hear how he's acting to us? They were, this Israelite army was not a bunch of wimps. They were trained in battle, but they kept asking the same question. Do you see what he's doing to us? Do you see how he's acting? And David learned that the most important questions will be what gives you the victory. He said, "What will be done with this man who stands up? What will be done with the man who kills and removes the disgrace from Israel? And who does he think he is to defy the living armies of God?" David wasn't asking, "Hey, did you see this guy that keeps coming out against us?" David asked, "What will I get once I take this giant's head off?" I think that's good. And they said, "Well, there's some good news. You're going to get a wife, you're going to get paid, and you're going to have no taxes." And David said, "Count me in." Count me in. Can I tell you, church, we got to learn as believers to start to rise up, ask the right questions. Not what am I going to do after the divorce, but where, honey, are we going to go on vacation next summer? I believe that God is going to put things back together again. I believe that God is going to mend things. What are we going to do when we get beyond this mess? When we know that Jesus is going to take us to the other side, will we go back to business as usual? Will we go back to acting the way that we've always acted? Or will we believe and say the right or ask the right question? I want to look past that. I want to say, "God, what do you have planned for my children?" I see my children as world changers. I see them coming to the throne room of Jesus Christ and giving their heart to you. I see my relationships being mended. I know that they're going to look like you, God, because you are putting it back together. You know what? I've got faith on the other side of this mess is Jesus. And he is going to give us the strength to rise above every obstacle that we face right now. And he will give us the victory. And we will have the victory in Jesus Christ. That's a good place to stand up in your living room. Get up on your couch. Grab a lampshade. Put it on your head and dance around for a few minutes. Because you know that you have the victory. I'm not just preaching something to you today that I don't know myself. I believe what God's Word has said. And what we're thinking in our heart is the obstacle that we're facing right now. What is right in front of us, what we're thinking about in our heart, is the obstacle that we are. And whatever your fault is, if it's defeat, you will be defeated. But if it's victory, I believe you will have victory. I'm going to tell you this. Don't ask the question based on fear. Ask them in faith. I just wonder what my children are going to do. I know they're going to graduate. I know they're going to go to college. I know that they're going to do great things. God, I just want to see what you do in their life in the future, because I know it's good. I know it's good. You promised it in your words. I'm not looking to defeat, but I am looking to faith and not fear. Let me read to you Proverbs 23 and 7 as we get ready here. Just a few moments to close this out. David changed the way he thought. Let me back up. David's thought pattern was not seeing himself the way that everybody else did. He saw himself the way that God saw him. So if you change the way you think, look at this. you're going to change what you see. David didn't look and just see a giant. He looked beyond the giant, and he saw the God that he served. He didn't just see that the giant had a big weaver's beam. He didn't just look that he had on all of this armor and that David was dressed in his normal attire with a sling in his hand and five stones loaded up in a bag. He believed that when God got in the mix, in the middle of the mess that Israel was in, he could load one stone in the middle of that sling and give it a whirl, and it would land right where it needed to on the giant's head, and the giant, the huge obstacle for Israel, would hit the ground and they would have the victory. I'm telling you, you got to change the way you think and you will change what you see. David saw everything that everybody else had seen for 40 days, but he chose to look beyond it. Can I say this to you? You got to look beyond the social media posts. You got to look beyond what the news channels are putting out. You got to trust God. You got to believe that He's got victory on the other side of this. I'm asking you today, what about you? Who are you trusting? Who are you looking to? Who are you looking to today? Who are you trusting? Today, we're facing the biggest obstacle that my parents, that I, my children, and many of your grandchildren have ever seen in our lifetime. Some of our families have faced wars. They've been through the Great Depression. They faced Ebola. They faced SARS. They faced obstacles of all sorts. But nothing has shook the world like COVID-19. But I want you to know today, my hope is not in the governments of this world. I pray for my leaders, every one of them, because they are our leaders, and I respect what they say. But I just want you to know something. My hope is not in the governments of this world, but it's in God's promises. And I want you to be strong in the Lord, not weak. I want to raise up, I want to help be a part of what God's doing and raise up a church, raise up a community that's not weak in the Lord, but we're strong in the Lord. That we're not on the defense every time somebody posts something that we don't like, but we're on the offense. And we say, God, I'm going to step up to the challenge. What can I do to meet the needs of my community, to help those that are hurting right now? What can I do? What can I do? We have to decide if we're going to retreat or we're going to advance. And God knows that there's absolutely no way that you can bypass the battle. But I got this promise that He said He promised to hold my hand and to walk with me all the way, and He will hold your hand too. I want to remind you of our anchor scriptures. We're getting ready to bring this to a close. He said, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials, look at this, of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete. Look at this, not lacking anything. Not lacking anything. Consider it pure joy. God, I don't understand. Son, if you'll find joy, if you'll change your perspective, if you'll stop looking at your supply and start looking to your source, which is me, which is God, I'm going to carry you through this storm. I'm going to help you. I'll remove obstacles when I need to remove them when you're a baby. But I'm telling you, some of you are grown adults. You've been in the Lord. You're mature in God. And God's saying, it's your time to stand up in faith and step forward. Look beyond the obstacles and look to me. And trust me, I want to pray for all of you here today. I want to pray for you. I'm going to look in that camera and pray this prayer. Father, I pray that every person that's listening today, that's facing obstacles, will not take them out, but that it will strengthen them. I pray, Lord, that anyone who's been living in doubt, any Christian, Lord, that has been living in doubt, a believer that has lived in doubt, God, that their faith will begin to arise within them, that they will be able to look beyond. I thank you, Lord, for calling us to advance the kingdom of God in this hour. This is the greatest hour of the church right now. We know that you gave David the victory, and you're going to do the same for us. Lord, I pray that you will keep us from engaging into battles that waste our energy on things that absolutely do not matter. Lord, I pray that you would help us to trust you. Lord, that we would have faith and live in faith and not live in fear. Lord, we ask this and we believe this and we pray this in the most powerful name that could be named in heaven and earth, the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for that one person that's far from you now. I ask you to touch their life. Lord, I pray that they would right now ask you into their heart. Father, as we pray this, Jesus, we ask you to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our trespasses. Forgive us of those that we've sinned against. Lord, we ask you into our heart. We ask you to forgive us of our sins. Lord, we pray that you would look upon America, God, and hear the cry, Lord, a cry of forgiveness now. And Lord, we pray that you forgive us of our sins, that we will trust you by faith as we ask you to come into our life. And Father, for us to trust you with our life. We believe this. We pray this, Lord. We confess to you that we're not able to do this alone, but that we need you now. And we believe all of this again by faith. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. God bless you. Go and have the best week ever. We love you from Refuge Church. We will see you Wednesday night. God bless.